Thanks for the introduction. I am very pleased to be here, even if it is, you know, online. So here is the rough description, rough outline of what I will tell you. First, I will tell you some general structure of perturbation theory in simple terms. We learn about perturbation theory at the first few orders in our basic classes, but as you go to higher and higher order, there is a very interesting structure that I will describe and that one can make precise. And as simple as it sounds, to understand this structure requires some new mathematical machinery. This mathematical machinery, you know, the first hints of it appeared in the works of Stokes. The Stokes, which was dynamics expert from the previous talk, he contributed to many things, you know, and now he also put some roots to the understanding of the nature of the perturbative series, in particular divergent series. And I will tell you some of these things in the context of quantum mechanics, a theory, you know, a quantum mechanical system, which has instantons. Then I will move on to quantum field theory, and these theories will have a technical problem, an important problem called Airy normalon problem. I will give you a physical description of the problem. And then I will discuss some new ideas in gauge theory, again, in roughly broad brush and at the conceptual level as much as possible, and describe some interesting things like fractional instantons in gauge theories. Then at the end of my talk, I will combine some ideas from topological field theory with the regular gauge theory, for example, Young-Mills theory, to provide a proposal for the IR renormalons in gauge theory. Okay. First, let me tell you something rather general about perturbation theory. So the general nature of perturbation theory is following. Assume you have some exact result or a result that you know through experiment, and assume you are trying to approach that result by some analytic techniques by doing perturbation theory. So why do we do perturbation theory? Because order by order, these things get better and better and better and better. That's the reason that we do perturbation theory. However, if you proceed, if you continue, ultimately the perturbation theory almost universally blows up, it diverges. And it diverges in such a way that this coefficient here, perturbative coefficient here, is like n factorial at order n. So if you plot consecutive terms in a perturbative expansion, here consecutive terms, it gets smaller and smaller and smaller, and there is an order at which the contribution is minimal, but after that, it blows up. So one of the brilliant realization of Stokes is that given a perturbative expansion parameter lambda, there is an optimal order at which the error is minimized. Okay, for example, if your coupling is like, you know, fine structure constant in QED 1 over 137, this optimal order is 137. But if your coupling constant is 0.2, after 5 orders, perturbation theory is destined to be doomed. So it will diverge very quickly. So there is something very interesting here. If you try at this order to find the nature of the theory, okay? If you try to determine the error is that, look, this term Cn lambda to n goes as n factorial lambda to n. And for the n factorial part, use Stirling approximation. And you will immediately realize that the error, by the error, I mean the deficit between the exact results and the absolute best, that perturbation theory can ever do is actually something of this form, exponential minus 1 over lambda. This is a quantity that you can never capture in perturbation theory, because if you try to Taylor extend this around 0, you will get 0 plus 0 plus 0. This is actually the ultimate reason why we learn perturbative and non-perturbative phenomena in books in different sections. Usually it's thought that they are unrelated to each other, but as this kind of idea of Stokes shows, actually the error, the intrinsic vagueness in perturbation theory is something non-perturbative. This is very interesting, and we will take a lot of mileage from these observations of Stokes. Okay, now I will describe a quantum mechanical system. It doesn't matter what this system is. I choose some periodic potential, say particle on a circle, 4 minima, but it can be 1 minimum on the circle, it doesn't matter. Or it can be infinitely many minimum on a line, like a lattice system. Or you can have a double well potential. It doesn't really matter, okay? Here is the thing. If you calculate some observable in this system, so there is some, for the observable, you can calculate some perturbative expansion. And perturbative expansion is an expansion in H bar or lambda. These two actually combine naturally. You can use either lambda or H bar. It doesn't really matter. And there are also usually in such systems, there are tunneling events from one of the wells to the adjacent one. And these things are described by these instanton effects, tunneling effects. And there is also perturbation theory around the instanton, okay? Now, I am told that there are many young people in the audience. So I hate to break the news to you, but the general nature of perturbation theory in quantum mechanics is that all of these perturbative series appearing for different observables are actually divergent asymptotic expansions. Okay? So this, for example, C0k around the perturbative vacuum diverges as k factorial at large order k. Or Cnk around the n instanton sector diverges again roughly as k factorial plus some constant, k plus some constant factorial. Now, there is actually an interesting way to give this whole combination a meaning. And I will describe you that in relatively simple terms. But first I will tell you something about perturbation theory around perturbative saddle. There is a machinery called Borel-Ri summation. The idea, it looks like analysis, but there is also geometry and topology behind it. But it would take much more time for me to describe that clearly. Okay, so I will give you a recipe, but you should know that there is also a geometry behind this description. And for me, that description is far more intuitive. And they are intimately related, okay? So assume you start with some divergent asymptotic series, okay? Something like this. So you do something called Borel transform, and it is like division of these coefficient A sub Q to Q factorial and define the function in some T plane called Borel plane. Now, let's do that. In general, if A sub Q is divergent like Q factorial, this becomes a geometric progression kind of thing. So it becomes a convergent series around the origin with a finite radius of convergence. Now, if you try to construct these Laplace transform, insert here this function BPT, the Borel transform. Actually, if you put this here and work order by order, it will give you back this perturbation theory, divergent series, okay? If you put the function and if these Borel transform does not have any ambiguities on real positive vectors, it will give you something nice and unambiguous. And it will be the physical answer, interestingly. But in general, this Borel transform will have singularities on positive real axes, like this. Okay, that BPT will have some singularity structure on the Borel plane on the positive real axis, for example. It can have in other directions too. But if you have such a situation, then clearly you cannot define this Laplace integral uniquely. You have to either go above it or go below it. This is something called left and right Borel resummation. And here is very interesting thing. This was a perturbation theory for a generic quantum mechanical system which has tunnelings in it. Okay. Now, you are starting with perturbation theory and you do this procedure. And the interesting thing is following. Of course, the result you obtain will have a real part, which is unambiguous. But depending on how you go around the singularities, it will have a twofold ambiguous imaginary part, this one. So, and this imaginary part is actually in all interesting quantum mechanical systems like this, it is proportional to two instanton factor in the theory. So this is interesting. You started with something which is a perturbative expansion, which was pathological. You did a Borel transform and you get a twofold ambiguous result. It still looks pathological, but you at least traded some infinity with something which is twofold ambiguous, okay? So this is good. So this is the result of perturbation theory, but the thing that you learn is that perturbation theory is twofold ambiguous, but the ambiguity is related to instanton in the game.
Hi, Mithat.
No.
Yeah, so I had a question. So suppose in theories which do not have tunneling, suppose anharmonic oscillator, so how do you interpret this non-perturbative term there?
It is some complex saddle. It's a complex saddle.
Okay.
It may or may not contribute to the PET integral. In the case of usual anharmonic oscillator, it actually turns out that it contributes to the integral. There is a criteria why it contributes, and that is cleanest to see in exact WKB by doing these Stokes graphs and stuff like that. It's the cleanest construction of that. This is some old work of Boros. And this is actually where, for example, geometry and topology enters in one way, because whether a complex saddle contributes or not is tied up with some things related to the topology of the head space.
Thanks.
Okay. So, these systems have instantons. You know, we, in the books, we usually see this, an instanton gas, you know, one instanton followed with another instanton and some anti-instantons, so on and so forth. But actually, if you are more realistic, once in a while, actually much rarer than the instantons themselves, there are these correlated events and you can make them precise. And things like instanton-instanton or instanton-anti-instanton. And in the past, these things caused too much confusion, okay? So if you try to, so if you take an instanton, its position is an exact moduli. Take another instanton, the center position is still a moduli. You can move it to the right, you can move it to the left, but the relative separation is something called quasi-moduli. So it is something that one needs to treat exactly in this construction. Okay? So to construct these correlated instanton events, one needs to do an integral over this quasi zero mode direction. And here is my instanton solution. I imposed, I did some superposition with another instanton or anti-instanton. And the usual story is that instanton-instanton is repulsive, instanton-anti-instanton is attractive. And let me remind you, especially for students, these are words that you will often see, attractive, repulsive. These are just words, and it is inheritance from old literature. And they caused too much confusion in the past. So this interaction just means that these combinations are not exact solutions at any finite separation. Okay, that's all. And as I said, this tau direction is called quasi-zero direction. Okay. Now, what do we do with this separation tau 1, 2? Before doing that, let me remind you something from statistical physics. So assume you consider some partition function of interacting gas, where interaction can be two-body, three-body, so on and so forth. And in the beta goes to infinity limit, if you try to construct the partition function, there is something fairly standard called cluster expansion. And you do get, you know, a contribution from the density of, you know, one event, one particle. You do get a contribution from, you know, things which are interacting with each other. And this part will, if you set V12 to be zero, okay, interaction to be zero, this will have two uncorrelated objects in itself. So two uncorrelated, since I'm talking about classical statistical mechanics, two uncorrelated particles. And this will just give you dilute gas. For example, you can obtain standards results in statistical mechanics from this kind of idea. But in general, there is interaction. And between our instantons as well, which are in the Euclidean description, which can be viewed as some sort of Euclidean particles, but they are instantons. They are space-time events. Do not forget that. There is some interaction between them. And if you write down this dilute gas approximation, there is an instanton contribution, anti-instanton contribution, and there is contribution from correlated pairs. Instanton-instanton, instanton-anti-instanton, so on and so forth. How do we calculate these things? Okay, instanton squares, which is a correlated event, which is something independent from two uncorrelated instanton. This is like a molecule, if you wish. And the way to do this is following. If you put this theory, quantum mechanical systems, the Euclidean time direction, you compactify it on a circle, then the interaction between an instanton and anti-instanton takes this form. Exponential minus tau, it can interact one way on the circle, or it can interact the other way, exponential minus beta minus tau. Now take the section, okay? And there is an overall sign, plus or minus. Find its critical points, you know, critical point of the section.
Sir?
Yes.
Sir, on what scale does this tau vary?
Say that again.
How does this tau vary? The factor that you have included in the exponential?
Ah, okay. Tau is, naively speaking, tau is a separation between instanton and anti-instanton. However, I will tell you that this is some sort of old and incorrect intuition. When you go to semi-classics, okay, semi-classics in the zeroth step tells you that you have to find critical points, then you have to find steepest descent cycles associated with them. So this is how tau varies. You know, when you do some, okay, when you consider integration cycle over tau, if you are considering instanton instanton, it varies on the positive, it varies on the real axis. Because the steepest descent direction of this thing is the real axis. Okay, it goes from minus infinity to plus infinity. But if you take an instanton anti-instanton are attractive in this old language. That means that in the real direction, these are attractive. That means that the real direction is not steepest descent, but steepest ascent direction. That is not your integration cycle. Okay, so.
Okay.
For instant, that's a very good question, by the way. And please continue to ask this kind of nice questions. So if you take an instanton and anti-instanton, okay, and if you try to find steepest ascent direction, this is the critical point at beta over two, it starts to go towards imaginary axis, imaginary direction. But then it turns around, and it builds this integration cycle that I have shown here. So when you are doing integration over this quasi zero mode direction, for instanton instanton, this is your cycle. For instanton anti-instanton, this other thing which lives in the complex domain is your integration cycle. And you can flip this shape, you know, this zigzag, this step-like shape, you can flip it. The other one is also a natural integration cycle. And this will actually come about in a very interesting way, because if you try to calculate this integral over this tau, it will give you this correlated event will be again twofold ambiguous. Okay, it will have some real unambiguous nice part, which is like two instanton contribution, but it will have twofold ambiguous result. This is very interesting. Look, a moment ago, I told you, you did some analysis in perturbation theory, and at the end of the day, from perturbation theory, you got something you thought pathological. It wasn't pathological, actually. It was a feature of perturbation theory, okay? Then we went ahead and we did some analysis related to instantons in the non-perturbative sector of theory. We calculated either instanton-instanton or instanton-anti-instanton amplitude. And we learned that instanton-anti-instanton amplitude is also actually twofold ambiguous. It is also a feature. The remarkable fact that remarkable fact is following. The ambiguity in perturbation theory, the thing that you thought pathological, cancels exactly with the ambiguity coming from this instanton anti-instanton. And the combination of the perturbative analysis after Borel resummation and after combining with these non-perturbative effects is actually meaningful and ambiguity-free. Now, this is actually very interesting story, because when I first realized this story, I was very impressed. And actually, the part of this story is understood by Bogomolny and Zinjustan in early 80s, okay? Actually, this leading part is understood, this n factorial growth and instanton, anti-instanton amplitude, this leading part is understood by Bogomolny and Zinjustan. But people cared very little about it, because some of the tools they used were not completely reliable to the taste of other theoretical physicists. But there was a question, what is really the integration cycle? So the thing that these authors did in the past is that they chose the integration cycle zero to infinity, which is not quite correct. And they, for the attractive case, they did some analytic continuation and back analytic continuation, and it is somehow correct, because neither of these prescriptions actually give you the full integration cycle correctly. It's a deep problem, okay? And around 2013, Gerald Dunn and I tackled this problem and showed that actually you can also calculate perturbation theory around this instanton and anti-instanton. You know, there will be order G expansion, order G square expansion, so on and so forth. But the divergence of the perturbation theory is not only restricted to n factorial. There is also n minus n factorial, n minus 2 factorial, so on and so forth. And these things are all tied up with each other. The way that perturbation theory behaves around this non-perturbative saddle dictates how the perturbation theory diverges at large orders around the perturbative saddle. So these two saddles are not independent of each other. One of them carries all the information about the other. Look, this is all the information about non-perturbative saddle. This is also information about non-perturbative saddle. And it is present here in a coded form, okay? And then we understood that this kind of relation holds actually if you proceed. This is wonderful. You can go ahead and look to other examples. For example, double wells, like this textbook example, there's a rate of divergence, et cetera, et cetera. And there is imaginary ambiguous parts, and they all cancel out each other very neatly. So to summarize, let me state what we learned. So this is the idea of resurgence, okay? It tells you that fluctuation about the instanton anti-instanton saddle are determined by the large orders of perturbation theory, by the behavior of the large orders of the perturbation theory around the perturbative saddle. And it wasn't actually before us. We did this in the PET integral context, but there is a beautiful paper by Berry and Hals, and they realized this kind of structure in the context of ordinary integral, one-dimensional integral, exponential integral. In a more pedagogical talk, I would start with that, but yeah. So this is one of the structures. There are other very fascinating structures in the perturbation theory, but this is the thing that I will borrow for my quantum field theory discussion. Any questions? So take this cancellation as your guide now, okay? Something between large orders of perturbation theory and instanton anti-instanton. You can ask the following very reasonable question, and people did this in the late 70s. Can this kind of idea work in quantum field theory? For example, QCD in four dimensions or CPM model in two dimensions. And there is a very famous answer to this question, mainly by Tuhoft. The answer is no. And the reason is following. And for two dimension, there's a similar thing. If you look to instanton, anti-instanton related singularity in the Borel plane, and this is tied up with some combinatorial structure of the Feynman diagrams, it is actually located at 2s instanton, as in quantum mechanics. But what Tuhoft showed is that this Borel transform has other and far more important singularities much closer to the origin of Borel plane. It is like 2s instanton divided by beta naught, and beta naught is the renormalization group beta functions first leading coefficient. It is like 11/3 n for Fourier-Yang-Mills theory. Okay? And Tuhoft called these, and these do not come from the combinatorics of the Feynman diagrams. They come from phase space integration. The fact that low momentum end of some integrals that appear some correlation function lead to certain type of divergence of perturbation theory, which is controlled by these far more important singularities. So Tuhoft called these singularities IR normal on singularities, and with the hope and expectation that maybe there is something related to them, something like a saddle or something like that. But he couldn't personally come up with something. And in retrospect, I think he did, but in the perspective of 40 years later, okay? At his time, no such configuration was known. So there was instanton solutions, and this is a genuine fundamental problem because it tells you that you do not know how to fix some of the pathologies of perturbation theory, starting with the microscopic dynamics. Okay, now what happens in Yang-Mills theory? Let me rephrase it more slowly. There is an instanton anti-instanton singularity, and instanton action is 8 pi squared divided by g squared. So the singularity is at 16 pi square. And the leading renormalon singularity is at this 16 pi square divided by this factor here, divided by n, roughly up to a numerical factor, okay? Now, here is a question. So why did everything work in quantum mechanics? Because in quantum mechanics, we are able to do semi-classics. The instanton size is not a moduli. Instanton size is fixed, okay? So we can do a meaningful dilute instanton gas approximation. In pure Yang-Mills on R4, this is not something we can do. If you find the instanton, instanton size is actually a moduli of the instanton. So it can be any size. So there is no meaning in the following assumption, saying that, for example, the separation between an instanton and anti-instanton is much larger than instanton size. This statement is meaningless in Yang-Mills theory or CPN model or any other classically scale invariant theory with instantons because instanton size can be anything, okay? Now let us change the question. The question, the new question is following. Let's say we are able to make some of the most interesting quantum field theories at our disposal semi-classically calculable, okay? You can say, is this even possible? But there is actually a program, okay. Let me phrase this more carefully, okay? One idea is following. You can keep the space locally four-dimensional, okay? Since the theories we are considering are asymptotically free, maybe you can think shrinking one of the directions in the space. And by asymptotic freedom, the theory at the scale of compactification becomes weakly coupled. But as it is well known, there is usually, for example, in Peirce-Mills theory, there exists a phase transition between this small circle regime and large circle regime. So this is the famous confinement-deconfinement transition. So whatever you learn here will not help you up there in the low temperature phase. So on the other hand, if you really were to go to this regime, to small circle regime, without any phase transition, you could end up with a genuinely weakly coupled theory, and you could study the non-perturbative dynamics. And if there is really an adiabatic continuity, you can proceed from small circle to large circle, okay? And this idea was put forward in a paper I wrote with Larry Yaffe a long time ago, now 13 years ago. And in the context of Peirce-Mills theory, it amounts to the following. As I said, in Peirce-Mills, in the regular theory, when you compactify it on a circle, there's a confinement-deconfinement type phase transition. And in fact, it turns out that you can prevent that phase transition by introducing something which looks ad hoc first, but it is actually far more interesting than it looks. It's something like a double trace deformation, which actually stabilizes the theory in the confined phase, even if you go to this small circle regime. This is something we called deformed Yang-Mills theory. It's a double trace deformation of the Yang-Mills theory. And this deformed Yang-Mills theory is adiabatically on small circle, is adiabatically connected to the theory on R4 in the sense of all gauge invariant order parameters. Okay. This is interesting, actually. This regime now, the coupling constant is weak. And because of this deformation, something very interesting happens. If you look to Polyakov loop, omega, with this deformation, the minimum of this thing is that this Polyakov loop has n eigenvalues, okay? And in the phase, all of these eigenvalues attract each other and they clump. But when you put this deformation term, they actually repel each other and makes the trace of the Polyakov loop zero. So this is the deconfined phase. And this is after you insert this double trace deformation and at weak coupling, the fluctuation of the eigenvalues are small. And this is sort of a cartoonish picture for the strong coupling. You know, eigenvalues fluctuate very rapidly and so on and so forth. Now, here is the interesting thing on small circles. If you start with SUN gauge theory, this Polyakov loop around the circle behaves as an adjoint Higgs field, which can be used to abelianize the dynamics at long distances. Okay, at short distances, you still have SUN Yang-Mills theory, and at long distances, the dynamics abelianize. In certain respect, this is very similar to Polyakov model or Sayer-Fitton theory. Okay? And when this abelianization happens, there are of course W bosons and photons. There are degrees of freedom which remains gapless to all orders in perturbation theory, and there are W bosons. But since W bosons are heavy, the running coupling, which under normal circumstances was supposed to grow on R4, for example, ceases to grow completely. And there is no running induced by charged particles, so on and so forth, because they decouple from the dynamics. So you reduce these SUN dynamics to abelian dynamics, and you have these n minus one dual photons. Now comes the sort of hero of the story. There are actually, because of this breaking, there are actually monopoles. These are the instantons in three dimension. They are finite action configurations. And there are n of them. The extra one, the nth one, which is on the same footing with the previous n minus one of them, is due to the fact that our holonomy field is compact, something to do with the topology of your Higgs fields. And this structure is actually first understood long time ago by Van Balkran, Li Yi, and Li Lu, the fact that these things exist. But they did not show, you know, they did find this, for example, in Van Balkran, they assumed such an abelianizing holonomy in the strong coupling regime. They did not have this double trace tool, which makes these things much more immediately visible. Okay, so there are these monopoles, and they do some very interesting things. If you look to these monopoles, first of all, one of the striking things is that their topological charge is 1/n of the instanton. So here is this theta angle appearance. Theta angle appears with a factor of 1/n. So when you have n minus one photon in three dimension, you can dualize them to a scalar, and these monopole amplitudes has this dual scalar, and this B field is fluctuation of the holonomy. Note that there is an I here associated with the magnetic charge of the monopole, and there is no I here for the in front of the gauge holonomy. Some people makes this mistake. You know, despite the fact that there is no I here, they think of this as electric coupling with, you know, with the gauge holonomy. It is not. This object does not have an electric charge. It is important not to make this mistake. It's very, this is really a monopole event. It is finite action. It only has magnetic charge and topological charge 1/n. It is not in particular related to, in an immediate way, to something called dyons with both electric and magnetic charge on R4, okay? You should keep this in mind. So if you consider the proliferation of these monopole instantons, they generate a mass gap for gauge fluctuations. This is similar to Polyakov model. However, this is not what I would like to do. Here is the interesting thing. If you calculate monopole, anti-monopole, correlated event, and if you construct steepest descent cycle associated with it, you can actually show that monopole, anti-monopole event is actually twofold ambiguous. And this ambiguity in the Borel plane is located at 2 times instanton action divided by n. Now, this is almost some years after, it's not important. So if you look, for example, to gluon condensate in this regime will receive contribution from monopoles, this kind of other charged objects. These are called bions, and these MM bar pairs are called neutral bions. It will receive contributions as such. But there will be a twofold ambiguity. And interestingly, it will be in the Renormalon territory, okay? Now, by leading this kind of ideas in 2012, with Philip Argyres and Gerald Dunn, two independent work, we conjectured that these neutral bions and neutral topological molecules are semi-classical avatars of Tu-Hooft's elusive Renormalons. If you are, as I said, there is a, these factors do not match. There is a 5/11 here, 1/n there. So the factor of 1/n matches, but not the prefecture. But this is okay because we are not really studying gauge theory on R4. We are studying the gauge theory on small circle, which is supposed to be adiabatically connected to R4. So it did, and if you do the same analysis for CPN model, actually study the theory on R2 versus R times S1, these neutral bions matches exactly with the CPN IR normal on positions, because you know in CPN beta function is just n, and these things captures them as they are. So at the time we were content with the singularities at 1/n, and it was I was personally very happy because at least we thought that we found something at position 1/n relative to usual instanton anti-instanton, and this is a good hint for the IR renormalon. However, recently, almost 10 years after, 9 years after from these works, people started to criticize these things. I think in criticize these things, saying that these two things do not agree. We already said in our paper that they do not agree. Only the factor of 1/n does. But still, one wishes to understand better, okay? So one would like to ask the following question. Is the semi-classical result on small circle, is it in contradiction to the result on R4? Now, to answer this question, we have to be able to carry over some results that are reliable in semi-classical domain to a domain which is outside region of validity of semi-classics. Actually, this analysis that I did with Larry Yaffe with this deformed Yang-Mills based on these monopoles is only valid when L is lesser than lambda inverse. You can show that there is a hierarchy of scales. The W bosons are parametrically heavier than photons, and that parameter turns out to be 1/ln, roughly speaking. And when that parameter becomes of order one, your EFT is not proliferation of monopoles is no longer valid. So you cannot really continue your effective field theory to large circle. Can you do something else, okay? So here comes the second part of my talk. I hope this discussion of deformed Yang-Mills is clear. The main lesson is that you have to take is that there are these monopole instantons which have action 1/n of the instanton action. They do not have size moduli. They do not have standard problems of the instanton analysis on R4. And if you take correlated events of this M and M bar, they induce singularities in the Borel plane, which are at 2/n of the instanton action, okay? Now, here comes the most recent part of my discussion. This is something I did during last year. And this is, you can call it QFT coupling in Yang-Mills, or you can also call the same section Cantu-Hooft help to Hooft. The meaning of this sentence is following. Actually, TQFT concept, at least one origin of it is to Hooft discrete flux backgrounds, or it is really the most physical manifestation of that I know of these TQFTs. And I would like to use that idea to introduce to discuss some things related to IR renormalon problems. I would like to use some robustness of these two QFTs to carry over some stuff from weak coupling domain to strong coupling domain. Any questions so far to this part?
Sir, if you could emphasize on what's the physical significance of theta that arose there in the equation where Yang-Mills monopole term was talked about?
I did not hear well, but you asked something theta angle, right?
Yeah.
The very important thing is that this theta actually appears here as theta over n. And if you calculate the observables in the semi-classical domain, they actually, the observables, I will come to this. This is a good question, and I will come to this because there will be structure, the functions will be multi-branch functions of theta, where each branch is 2 pi n periodic, and semi-classics derives that.
Okay, and sir, one more question. When you say that the size of an instanton can be greater than the distance between an instanton and an anti-instanton, I assume that you are comparing distances on the spatial dimension, right? Like as the name.
These are space-time events. So this is Euclidean events, okay?
Okay.
So all I am saying is that instanton size on R4 or on R2 in the Trigard is a moduli.
Okay.
So it can be anything. So people talk a lot about dilute instanton gas, and it is very often not meaningful. Very often.
But isn't that understood that an instanton by its meaning would appear or disappear instantly? I mean, and this is a naive question that's arising in my mind right now.
So I will make that question precise as well. This is, if you think on the perturbative, it's a technical question related to Lefschetz symbol. People used to think that instanton, anti-instanton can disappear when you bring them together. Think of it. It is an action to object, two units of instanton action object. It is continuously connected to perturbative vacuum on the steepest ascent cycle, not steepest descent. On the steepest ascent, this steepest descent cycle, it never come close to that. It never annihilates. This is again a mistake that emanates from 70s and that comes today, unfortunately.
Okay.
Oh, sure. Now I will talk about a part which will at first sound a little bit technical. But then I will sidestep this technicality and go quickly to Hooft's discrete flux discussion. So Yang-Mills theory in four dimensions, of course, has a Zn one-form symmetry. And if you want, in SU and Yang-Mills theory, you can actually turn on, this is a one-form symmetry. So if you want to turn on a field associated with it, it will be a two-form field. It is something called B2, okay? So if you want to turn on a background field for this discrete symmetry, you can turn on these two form fields. And these two form fields is valued, integral of B2 is valued in 2 pi over n z. And this B2 integral, if you think of the theory on a four torus, there are six cycles that you can put this. So these are really the two of fluxes. And in the modern language, this thing is called a Zn, the construction, associated with this B2, B1 field is called a Zn TQFT, topological quantum field theory. And this is the work of Kapustin and Seibert. But at least in QCD community, we are aware of manifestation of this, TQFT coupling since very long while. Especially both, for example, I will come to that, but both Van Baal as well as Tony Gonzalez Arroyo and their collaborators are very well aware of these things, and they did many, many interesting things with this idea. It is not an idea. The point I want to draw is that it's not an idea used in Yang-Mills starting with 2014. Even 1982, there are very interesting works, 1980s. So if you couple this TQFT to Yang-Mills theory, Yang-Mills theory takes this form, okay? And it has now one form gauge invariance, okay? So you can, the presence of this background modifies the instanton equation. F minus B2 is equal to, in this form, okay? And if you would like to calculate the action, action takes this form, and action is quantized in units of 1 over n. But now, in this SUN theory, coupled to the Zn background, the configurations which satisfy this BPS bound have action as instanton over n. But remember, in our monopole discussion, there we had monopoles with detection 1 over n, there was no two-hoofed flux background. There was no TQFT. It was genuine compactification of the theory. But the thing that is interesting when you couple this to this Yang-Mills theory to TQFT is that this statement, the fact that topological charge is quantized in units of 1 over n, is true both in weak coupling as well as in strong coupling, okay? Both at small T4 as well as large T4, okay? Now, here comes a very interesting observation, and I will make an observation first, then I will do something interesting with it. So if you consider partition function of SUN theory, okay? This is something I suspect many people in the audience know. So it is a sum over instanton sectors, which are classified by these integers, winding number or instanton charge, okay? So this is just actually a classification of the SUN bundle. If you consider SUN theory in two-hoofed flux background, okay, L and M are two-hoofed fluxes. These are the partition function in this flux background can still be written as a sum over SUM bundles, okay? But so it is still in SUN theory, okay? And the sum is like that, but the topological charge is modified. Instead of being integer, there is this L dot M divided by N factor. And now if you want to gauge bound form symmetry, center symmetry, and obtain, when you gauge that, you obtain SUN mod ZN theory, but there are multiple SUN mod ZN theories, and it's a technicality that I don't want to go right now. And if you obtain PSUN theory, the bundle structure of the PSUN theory is much richer. Apart from these topological charge, which is integer valued, you also sum over these n to the six discrete flux sectors, okay? So this is the partition function of the SUN theory, okay? So the action, if they obey BPS bound, the action of the configurations are bound by S instanton divided by N if you are in the PSUN theory, okay? So here is a question, okay? So clearly the action of the configuration in the PSUN theory are determined by S instanton divided by M. You can ask, what is the, considering that, this is important. When you couple SUN to TQFT, if you are on sufficiently large T4, you are changing exactly nothing locally. You are changing something globally, but locally nothing changes. And perturbation theory, the behavior of perturbation theory, IRG normal on problems, and so forth, are all local questions, okay? Now, here is the interesting thing, observation. The non-perturbative expansion parameter on T4 is controlled by S instanton divided by N. But not S instanton as it would be in SUN Yang-Mills. So here I made a diagram, which is at the heart of the remainder of my talk. So if you consider something like Yang-Mills theory, topological charge is quantized in integer units. And according to BPS bound, action is also quantized in integer units. And I would like to question that statement. So if you couple to Zn, you learn that topological charge has this form, fractional form, and make it, for example, PSUN, and action can also assume fractional values. But here is the interesting thing. If you lift up this structure back to SUN again, topological charge is, because if you have an object with topological charge 1 over n and minus 1 over n, the combination of them is still in the SUN bundle, but its action is 2 over n. You are allowed to have topological charge 0, but action 2 over n objects. Okay, this is very important. Okay, and this is a major difference from the standard perspective. Now, I think I will have some troubles with time, but still, I hope not.
It's about an hour, I think.
Okay, how much time do I have left?
Actually, it's been about an hour, so but maybe you can have 10 extra, 5 or 10 extra minutes if you can
finish. 10 would be perfect. I would be grateful, actually. Now, here is the interesting thing. For example, if you, instead of this picture, let me give you an intuitive picture. It will be faster. Okay. If you consider, this is another model, but it doesn't matter. If you consider, for example, take something like Polyakov model, okay, and put it on T2 times R. And you can construct zero flux sector, different magnetic flux sectors. You know, you can classify, you can turn, this is the usual zero flux sector, you can turn monopoles in Polyakov model or deformed-Yang-Mills to instantons in quantum mechanics. You can do this mapping. And you can also show that these, for example, in SU2, these higher flux sectors have higher energy. For example, you define this flux through this T2, and energy of this higher flux configuration is proportional to 1 over A, 1 over area. So if you do not insert any two flux, okay, then zero magnetic flux sector and higher flux sectors through T2 are not degenerate. They only become degenerate when you take area to be very large. Okay, this is the standard perspective. For example, you can find this statement in Tom Bax's book on how monopoles manifest themselves in Polyakov model. But the bad news is, if you are doing Born-Oppenheimer approximation in quantum mechanics, you only have these perturbative vacua with zero magnetic flux. So monopoles in the Born-Oppenheimer approximation in quantum mechanics on small T2 do not survive. But now do something interesting. Insert one of magnetic flux, okay? Then you can actually show that magnetic, the flux sectors, which used to be zero flux, now with this background, it will be plus 1/2, and minus 1/2 with this background will be minus 1/2. They are actually exactly degenerate. So this tells you the following. If you insert two Hooft flux on some T2 times R, et cetera, you can make the perturbative vacuum with some flux sector exactly degenerates. You can make instantons survive in the quantum mechanical discussion. I give this discussion in the context of monopoles. However, there is a, so this is my picture. You can start with some flux, another flux sectors, and these two have the same two flux, nu1 and nu2, are associated with the same magnetic analogy, so they have the same magnetic flux, okay? But they have different magnetic flux, but the same discrete two flux, okay? So this kind of tunnelings are now allowed even in the quantum mechanical limits. Actually, there is a very old and very nice works by Tony Gonzalez Arroyo, who is also a speaker in this program, and Margarita Garcia Perez and their students, I think Marga was a student of Tony anyways, which actually explore this idea, but not with the monopole events, which appears quite manifestly when the dynamics abelianize, but they study in theories which do not abelianize. What they do has a very high merit of its own, because what they do actually, at least in my opinion, unambiguously show that, for example, there exists time-dependent fractional instanton solution with actions 1 over n. It is very hard to find this solution analytically, unlike monopoles. And I think that that's one reason that people may approach it with skepticism, but the numerical data is quite unambiguous, at least in my opinion. So, but these monopoles now make this picture much more clearer. So indeed, there are these other kind of monopole events. For example, if you go to SU4 theory, okay, you start with some magnetic background flux, nu one, which is in the covalent lattice of SU4. And you can do this tunneling alpha one, alpha two, alpha three, alpha four. And all of these states, nu one, nu two, nu three, nu four, are degenerates. And there are these monopole instantons, and you can construct these solutions in the quantum mechanical limits, starting with quantum field theory by using method of images, for example. Okay. This is very nice. What does it have to do with the IRE normalon problem? Now, if you calculate the gluon condensate, I think one of the biggest success of these ideas of, you know, Wambal, Gonzalez Arroyo, as well as my work with Larry Affe and follow-up works is that if you try to calculate gluon condensate in the semi-classical regime, they produce this multi-branch structure where each branch is 2 pi n periodic, but the function itself is determined by extremization of this multi-branch structure, and the function itself is a function of theta is 2 pi periodic. This is the effect of fractional instantons or monopole instantons. This is the effect of some higher effects. And here comes the other hero of my story. There is an ambiguity coming from MM bar, which is proportional to strong scale to the power 22 divided by 3. And as it stands, it would correspond to a singularity in Borel plane around 7, not 4. Okay. And it would induce this singularity in Borel plane at this location. And the gluon condensate on R4 is expected to be of this form, this multi-branch structure. And this is something written down by Witten in 1980s. I think this fantastic result of semi-classics is quite underappreciated. It really tells us that these semi-classical ideas were on the right track in the old times, and they are on the right track even now. Now I will make some interesting observation, okay? So here's the thing. In the monopole events, there is this appearance, exponential I theta over n k, where k is an integer. This combination always appears from calculable semi-classics on M4. But now I want to make another observation. The function that appears on R4 is h theta over n. It can be expressed in a complete Fourier basis, which is the span of exponential I theta over n k. And it forms a complete basis. You see one thing. There is a complete basis describing this kind of functions, and there is a basis coming from the semi-classical analysis. And these two bases are same. I think it means something. Okay. So now this decomposition, however, exponential I theta over n k, it is inevitable. You can think of either at small M4 or large M4. It is really a consequence of thinking SUN theory carefully in TQFT backgrounds. And we learned that all the non-perturbative observables must be multi-branched or multi-branch, where each branch can be decomposed to this complete basis, and each branch is 2 pi n periodic, but the observable is 2 pi periodic. I think I made this point, you know, the completeness of Fourier basis versus this Lefschetz symbol decomposition. I think it gives some realistic hope that this story is very likely on the right track. And in fact, we can actually prove related statements in quantum mechanics by WKB. But here is the question. Moving outside the domain of comfort, domain of semi-classic. So we know that semi-classics is not adequate to address the question of what happens at large T4. However, Polyakov, for example, in his book argues that if the finite correlation length of the system cuts off the growth of the instanton size, the EFT pushed at the region of its, at the boundary of its region of validity can describe physics qualitatively correctly, not quantitatively, but qualitatively. So the region of validity is when this R function becomes of order lambda inverse. Look, if R is lambda inverse, what happens to this combination? This combination becomes something of the form lambda to four, some complete Fourier basis discussion and ambiguities of the form plus minus a lambda to four, okay? So it tells you that if you make the assumption that there is a saturation for the, when the strong coupling kicks in for the monopole instantons, then these singularities, 2s instanton divided by n moves to 4s instanton divided by beta. Not much of a move, you know, from 7.1 to 4, okay, location. This is my last slide, okay? So this is my definition of IRG normalon. I think this discussion instructs us the following. It tells us that we can think of these IRG normalons, first starting from the semi-classical domain, as composites of fractional instantons in the PSUM bundle that can be lifted to SUM bundle. And this is in the semi-classical domain, this is what it is. And as you go to strong coupling regime, these configurations to get dressed up by strong dynamics. What I mean by this precisely is following. If this function R saturates to something of order of strong scale, which we expect, that actually amounts to, if the running coupling develops a singularity, something like a pole or branch point, and two loop beta function, renormalization group beta function does, that saturation happens. So as far as I can see, there is a unique way of making the story consistent. These theta angle periodicities and non-renormalization of theta. Theta over n must appear as theta over n, both at weak coupling and strong coupling. Do not underappreciate the importance of this statement. So there is a multi-branch structure of non-perturbative observables, and there is a weak coupling analysis on R3 cross S1, which is reliable. And there is a TQFT coupling on large R4, which tells us that, which tells us what we should expect on R4. And the story I told you is probably a consistent story of what happens as we go from weak coupling domain to strong coupling domain. And this is probably the resolution. I suspect it is the resolution of the IRG normalon problem. Thank you very much. I stop here.
Thank you very much. Any quick questions?
Can I ask one?
Yeah. Go ahead.
I'm Mithat. So I didn't quite understand your statement about this Lipschitz thimble thing. So the when you do an instanton, anti-instanton, monopole calculation, it is just like the semi-classical analysis, saddle point analysis, and the Lipschitz thimble is also a saddle point of the full quantum field theory, but with the action, say suppose for the QCD action. So how are they related to each other, or what statement were you making precisely?
Okay, so let me go to quantum mechanics, because what happens in quantum field theory is the counterpart of it. So if you take an instanton, anti-instanton, and on circle S1 beta, the critical point is that beta over two. If you make the circle size infinite, this critical point moves to infinity. This is called critical point at infinity. For instanton, when this is repulsive, the steepest descent path is this. So real axis. So, you know, most of the, so the point is, if you take instanton, anti-instanton, if you consider the steepest ascent cycle is real axis. And this is the sort of, you can think like perturbative vacuum. This is how this is connected to perturbative vacuum continuously. But steepest descent cycle for instanton, anti-instanton is not this. It goes through the complex domain. And even if you are here somewhere on the thimble, the interaction between them on the thimble is actually repulsive. They don't want to, if you just take real part of tau as your parameter, you know, they never become attractive in certain sense. If you do the integral for II bar on this steepest descent cycle, it is always repulsive. It must be, because it is the steepest descent cycle. Is that clear?
Maybe you should.
I cannot hear.
I can't hear her either. Maybe we should.
Sorry. Yeah, it is clear to me. Sorry. I was. Yeah.
You know, further questions, maybe we should thank the speaker and then.
Is there a question from Rob Pizarski?
I have a quick question. Hi, Mithat. Excellent talk. Thank you very much. I just wanted to ask, I just had a question. What if you have you considered a femtosphere where you put the theory on S3 cross R1? So, and you take a distance R for the three spatial dimensions, it's very small, so the coupling's small. Presumably, the instantons have the same action, the topological PQFT has an instanton divided by it. But I don't know about the renormalon.
So actually, S3 is not a good topology to turn on two flux backgrounds. So to have these discrete flux backgrounds, you have to have non-trivial two cycles. So you have to have something like T2. So the femtosphere is fundamentally different there. It has its own other virtues. And you can actually, if it is large femtosphere, you can still have things like proliferation of monopoles, that's okay. But this TQFT discussion does not go through to this femtosphere.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you for the question.
Any further questions? Okay. But let's thank the speakers.